Tolerators, this is To All the Men I've Tolerated Before with Natalie Katona, your weekly look at everyday misogyny. Today, we are happy to have back with us Julia Washington from Pros and Glow, Pop Culture Makes Me Jealous, and Jelly Pop's Book Club. Julia has entered her rom-com era, and we're going to offer her some support as she goes over how her relationship expectations have changed. Isn't that weird, me supporting the idea of romantic comedy romance?
But romantic comedy romance is so lovely because they aren't murderers in it. So there's an HEA. Things work out.
Honestly, like, why I'm living for your rom-com era is because you're just accidentally dating and loving yourself in the hopes of someone noticing.
Yes, that's 100% it. That's absolutely what it is.
Yeah. So I just watched the videos and I'm like, I don't even care if a man talks to her. I'm just so happy she's at the farmer's market.
Watching all these cute couples walk by thinking, yeah, I want that. Fucking hell. That's so irritating that I want that.
Well, and now the, I mean, we'll get to it into it eventually, probably because I'm a bummer. But Annie and I were talking last night at ramen. We were like, here's the thing. We think we want it because we have an idea of what it is. And then when the actuality of what it is hits us and it's some guy sighing and stomping and pouting because you're like, hey, the dishwasher is unloaded, so you can go ahead and throw that bowl right in there. Then I'm like, this isn't what I wanted.
Well, I actually think that that kind of interaction can be avoided if people just have measured expectations about living together and have discussion about living together. Because, like, over the summer, I had a very, very real conversation with my offspring about, like, hey, invisible labor is real. So you either need to shit or get off the pot if this is going to be a living situation that's going to be healthy and functional for everybody. And that's a thing you need to carry the rest of your life. I was like, this is why women are angry. And I'm not blaming women. This is not me blaming women. But having had conversations with my married friends who have now been married 10 plus years, a lot of it is like they're not talking to their husbands. They're nagging their husbands, they're berating their husbands, they're calling their husbands lazy to their face. Rather, and their husbands aren't offering because their husbands, no one's taught these men how to offer help. So it's like both parties are miscommunicating and then getting mad and throwing fits around the house. And I don't have that kind of time or energy.
It's wild living with a married couple currently because what I think is such like a non-confrontational sentence, like I unloaded the dishwasher, spirals into a confrontation. And I'm like, how did we get here? Like literally it was just an update.
Yeah, that's weird. That makes no sense to me. Like, I don't understand. And I know this is off topic. But I've entered my rom-com era and figuring out how I like living with me, how I like dating me, and like it seeps into how I have relationship with the people in my life, not just romantically, but like friends. And there's a lot of, oh, I'm not communicating clearly with what my expectations are or what my needs are, or even conveying like, no, I wasn't actually making a joke there. Like, so it's changing the way I'm interacting with people as well, because I'm seeing all of these like things that could be avoided. Because I don't know why are we like this? Like, why do we not just say clearly and succinctly, this is what I want, this is what I expect, is this something that we can work with? And I'm, yeah,
I think it's a lot of like long-term side effects of watching women be shot down every time they lean into having an expectation or a desire.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's a lot of watching Everybody Loves Raymond and adjacent sitcoms where like the wife is like, I thought we could go to Italian tonight. And then the entire hook of the joke is that she thought she was going to get to eat spaghetti that day, even though he wants a burrito.
Yeah, I mean, I guess I just feel like it's an opportunity. If like that's an opportunity to have a conversation. Like I'm watching a friend right now who's made a decision to give her partner an ultimatum, but then when you sort of do a forensic of their relationship, neither one of them, their lives changed so much, and neither one of them paid attention to the other while the lives were changing. So now they're like 6 years into this new phase of life and no one's talked about it. And now it's like, well, I'm giving you an ultimatum. And it's like, but is that the right option? Because like things happen and you've never done an assessment. You've never done a check-in. Like, hey, how are we doing? Like, are you okay? Am I okay? And it's a failure on both parties, right? Like, because it should be, hey, I'm like I had to very clearly state to somebody recently, I'm not okay. I can't have you have those expectations of me right now. Because, you know, I had a very hard summer with some major health stuff that happened to a family member. And because I was so upfront about it, the tension melted away. Because it's like, now you know I can't do those things for you. I'll call you when I can. I may never call. I may never be in a position to do those things ever again. But it is very interesting to be like, girl in a position of like, how do I, and it's funny too, because didn't we talk about months ago about like, oh, I'm with our goals for 2024. And I was like, I need to figure out what love means to me. I need to understand what all of these things mean to me, because I want a relationship that is healthy and thriving. And I reject the notion that I can't find it. Will I stay single if I can't find it, or if it doesn't like present itself in my life? 100%. Because my peace is not worth being with somebody who I shouldn't be partnered with, like sacrificing my peace, you know?
Well, and I think that's where all of our work decentering the idea of love is the only goal or a husband is the only goal comes in, because there are a lot of women who will go, all right, he's an arm's length away from me and I have societal expectations, or I have this want and I'm tired of wanting it or whatever. Like how I tried to like sell my virginity to the highest bidder. I was like, who's going to answer this text message? I'm sick of having this.
Oh my gosh. I mean, yes, yes. And I also kind of can't stand all my married friends who've been married for as long as they have. And they're like, well, having a partner isn't everything. Okay. But you know what sucks? Having to go to the hospital 3 hours away every single day, having to hold your shit together because your family is like lost its mind, and then coming home and still having to hold your shit together because you have dependent children. Like, I'm not saying that those people would have partners who would step up. I'm just saying, like, I'm literally, bills got forgotten because I'm doing all of the things. Like, there's so many things about cultivating a partnership that even though in a marriage, some people might not feel like that's currently emotionally or physically satisfying. The point is that this is apples and oranges. Like, don't sit there and tell me, well, it's not all it's cracked up to be. Okay, fine. But you go and be a single woman in a society that is not designed for single women to succeed. So the women who have succeeded who are single, like, how? How?
I really thought I was doing it. And look at me now.
Literally write a book. And no, Cheryl, whatever her name is from Facebook, I'm not reading your book because you were married for a while. Like, I understand your husband died, but still, you still had a partnership that helped aid in your success. Like, it is so different. So when married people are like, oh, it's not always all it's cracked up to be. Sure, but you have a partner who literally is paying all the bills. So like, you can stress about other shit. I have to pay the bills. I have to make sure I have to cultivate relationships with family. Like, I'm not saying I'd be a trad wife. I hate that shit. What I'm saying is when the, like, I'm currently in a phase where like at that moment when my family structure was falling apart, it's like, wouldn't it be nice to be in the 1952 and have a husband who's paying bills and giving me health insurance in this very moment? But I'm also not running out looking for someone to fill that void because.
Right. Just because, just to have it, just to like, be like, right. Because I think the whole purpose of your rom-com era is being like, oh no, I'm going to get what I want. Like, yes. I'm not just coming up to pick up some guy named Jacob. Right. Pretend he's what I want.
Correct.
tell him he's everything that I want, and then not be able to stand the sight of him if he takes sick leave from his job or something.
Correct. Ignoring red flags, not being understanding of what my career needs are, what his career needs are.
Yeah.
Right? Like, not paying attention to how he interacts with other people. Like, if we go to a restaurant or whatever. And, like, so there's, like, little things where I'm just, like, these are not things you think about when you're 20 or 25. These are things that...
That's how a lot of our friends ended up in the marriages that they did. Mm-hmm. Because you're just thinking about the party and right. you're not thinking about Wednesday.
Right. Right. And like having a contingency plan, like the whole for better or worse part of marriage is real in sickness and in health, and marriage is real. And I understand the irony of somebody who's not married saying those things. But as a person who observed people who've been married for a long time recently not uphold certain parts of the in sickness and in health part, it's like, did you not understand that this could be an option? Like that yeah. this could happen? Like, it's that individualism too. It gets in the way of like partnership. Like we think, oh yeah, I want a big wedding. The trajectory is married by this time, kids by this time, 2.5 kids. I don't know if the new generation is the 2.5 kids thing, but for us, that was the thing, right? Picket fence, own a house, do all these things. And then now you're just like, no, but all of that is not always realistic. And like, we need to have a conversation because like, what if there's a car accident? What if somebody gets cancer? Like, I'm not saying to like catastrophize everything, but like have a real conversation about like, we're healthy now, but like, let's have a contingency plan. Like, what's your family's health history? Like, I'm watching another family unit. They have Alzheimer's in the family. And now there's a family member who's starting to demonstrate symptoms of that, but everyone's ignoring it. And I'm the only one who's like, hey, you know, it's like, we don't want to pay attention. We want to believe it's not going to happen to me. And then 10 years later, you wake up and shit's at the fan and you hate your partner and you hate your kids. And you're just like, I'm going to make everybody's life hell.
Yeah. Well, it's like when my grandmother was literally dying and they put her in the hospital, is like, you want a feel good pill because dying's rough. And we were like, oh my gosh, her mood's been so elevated and nice. And I was like, oh, and I'm 15. Yeah, I'm 15 or 16 years old. And I'm like, oh, are we all ready to talk about it? Are we ready to talk about that our chemicals as like a united generational, like DNA related family are fucked? And maybe we all need a little Zoloft, a little Prozac, a little Wellbutrin, whatever have you. And they were like, isn't that so nice for mom? And moved directly the fuck on. And I was like, I would like to know what it's like to feel peace before someone's just concerned because I have cancer riddling my body.
Right. Right. I think it's those expectations. Like, it is going into dating. It is very off-putting for people when we watch dating shows or we see people say like, these are the things I'm looking for. Well, you need to not have expectations. I'm not here for the vibe, bitch. I want to be safe in my home. I want to know that my partner's reliable. I want to know that, you know, in tough times, we can get through it together. I want to know that we can travel well together. Like, I'm not here for vibes. Vibes is secondary. Once we've, like, locked in all the things that matter, then we can talk about vibes. Like, dating shouldn't be about the vibes.
Dating is a job.
I mean, it kind of is, because you're literally saying, like, I'm looking for somebody to have and build a relationship with for decades.
Yeah.
But when you're 22, you're like, oh, this guy makes me feel so good right now. Right now. Like, vibes are great, but also make sure that you can, like, build something with that person. And that's the other part. It's like, well, they take everything off. Like, we get the list convoluted with, like, long-term planning. I don't know if that I'm making sense.
Tell me about the list. Are you talking about the list of haves and have-nots? Like, they will have like, this, they will not do this.
Okay. Yeah.
And then, so you're saying that, like, you can have your list of do's and don'ts, but that doesn't mean that you can take a plane ride to Hawaii together.
Right. Like, if you can't travel well together, and it is one of your goals in life to travel, we're not really going to take that into consideration.
You ever watch, like, a couple in their 60s, and she's like, I just really want to go to Paris. And he's like, I don't even want to go to Target down the street. And it's like, how did you two make this work?
Exactly. I guess that's literally my point. It's like, if there are things, like, why is it so off-putting that in the beginning you're like, here are all the things that I would like to do with my life. Does any of that sound appealing to you? Why is that a red flag? Why is that a no-no when you start dating?
Well, and honestly, I think in Love is Blind, that is what they're supposed to be doing, because they're just sitting in a room, in an empty room for hours talking to a wall.
Yes.
And then I don't know what happens during that experiment where someone feels compelled to lie, even though there's not like a visible component to anything. Right. So it's like, why are you trying so hard? Because I had that experience, right? Like I had the blind date, Love is Blind online experience where I'm feeding him a lot of information and he's nodding and he's cracking jokes and he's like, that's really great. And then he chooses me at the end. And then we're 3 weeks into a dating relationship and he's like, oh, I thought you were kidding about all of that. And it's like, why would I waste my time lying to you?
Yeah. You know, it's great that you bring up Love is Blind, because I was just talking about this the other day with somebody, because Love is Blind in theory is a great concept because it removes all of the stressors. Like if I'm in a room one-on-one talking to somebody, I'm not worried about how my rent's getting paid. I'm not worried about my daily life. I'm looking at the core of me and the core of you, so we can see if that foundation can be built. But then, like you pointed out, there is a disconnect because people are still bringing these weird expectations of dating to it, slash you need the daily life, you need the reality in there to also kind of bring in like, will in the foundational stuff, will this work? And even though they throw them into like a live together situation, it's still not real, because like my job is, well, my secondary job, which is the Pros and Glow, is literally Thursday and Saturday. So like Thursday and like Saturday, so that means Friday night is out. I'm in bed by 9. So if you're somebody who's like, well, I love going out Friday night and I want to hit up the comedy club and then go out for drinks after, I can't be your person for that, because like when I say I work Saturday morning, that also means it seeps into Friday night.
Yeah. Well, and I think, so in my mind, when I was doing fake Love is Blind, there were no stakes. There was literally no reason for me to lie. There was no reason for me to tell. Right. It wasn't AOL chat rooms. There was no reason for me to be like, I'm a busty blonde who's 28 years old and I am a manager of a Barnes and Noble. Like I wasn't creating a character. There were no stakes.
Yeah.
So I was still like out here living my truth, also believing that there are no stakes for anyone else. So they are also out here living in their truth. And I think what we see at Love is Blind is that first season, there were no stakes. So people let their freak flags fly. The second season, when people are like, oh, but I could get a free vacation and a deal with like MeUndies. Now there's money on the line. Like now there's like, oh, but I could be a public figure.
Yeah,
like,
yeah,
I could be one of the Real Housewives eventually. So I think that's what ended up ruining the love. I guarantee you that if you just did the Love is Blind experiment in like nowhere Midwest America in like the woods or something, it would probably work out because there are no stakes. If we get out there and I'm like, you're hideous. And he's like, joke's on you, I think that too. And we just walk away from one another. There are no consequences.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think too, women, in my experience of dating, online dating, women come to it with genuine intention. They're like, I'm determined to find someone who will be compatible with me. But the men who are doing the free versions of online dating aren't. They're just like, yeah, the best way to ask me out is to ask me out. No fucking shit. Like, duh. But it's like you have these different variations too, right? Like, so then if you do the paid for version, you do get a little bit of a better quality of a man, because he's like, well, I'm willing to pay for it to, like, find my person. But then at the same time, it doesn't matter. Women are, like, intentional at every phase, whether they have no money to pay for it or they have hundreds of thousands of dollars to throw at it.
Right, because it is one of my bullet points, is what we're seeing currently. Let us not forget, we're in the middle of a male loneliness epidemic, everyone. It's real scary out there. But what we're seeing is modern women who are single in their 30s or 40s, like Julia and I. We have expectations. We have lived a life. We have lived through things. And therefore, it's not just going to be some dude named Brad who gets to be in my life for kicks. But men still feel very entitled to dating being easy for them. So now we have this, like, dating gap. Like, we have an expectations gap of what relationships are actually supposed to look like, because we have a species of human who's evolved and a species of human who's had it easy their entire life. And,
well, sorry, go ahead.
And it's like, when are they going to catch up? Are some of them even trying to catch up? What does catching up look like?
I think a lot of it, too, is because we're the first generation who grew up with being able to have access to careers that would allow us to be independent of men and not needing to be partnered to an extent. Like, there are still scenarios and regions where, you know, the advantages of being married versus not economically are still pretty strong, which is garbage. With that said, I do think that as a generation, as the first generation who was able to do literally almost anything, I mean, with few exceptions, without needing a partner to give us permission to do it, we realized, like, oh, we can be happy and fulfilled without that. Versus, so, like, as we are being told, you can be anything, you can grow up to be anything, you can have any career you want, no one prepared boys for that. No one prepared boys for the fact that girls are working towards similar goals that they have in terms of, like, economic status, because it's just assumed boys are going to do those things, right? Like, the system was always designed for the man to be in that position and to have no problems and no failings, which is why it's always a red flag when a white guy can't make the system work for him. And so now we're seeing, you know, these guys who are similarly aged to us, and they have this archaic mentality, and you're like, how did that happen? And then you start kind of talking with them, and then you meet their family a little bit, and you're just like, oh, I understand. You were never prepared for the fact that you could meet somebody who has a career and isn't going to give it up to raise your children. Like, you're still in a world that is telling you that you need to find someone to keep your house. And even if you walk into it with, like, oh, I love that you have a career, I love that you have those things, it's still intrinsically within them to assume that if I'm the one that gets pregnant and children come into this home, I'm the one who's making the sacrifice in my career so we can have a family.
Hell, I haven't even birthed a child, but if I'm a lady in a uterus with a room, in a room where a child is present, do you think a man's going to go run to that child should they cry? No, they're going to be like, Natalie, a child, a child with a need.
And I think, and so we've never done anything to course correct the fact that we're giving women freedom and equality in a lot of ways and equity in a lot of ways, and have not done anything to prepare the little boys in our generation to become men who can accept that.
And then, so then I take it a step further, and it's actually, like, a joke I wrote in my sitcom script where, like, the young woman's mom is telling her, like, please don't wear a t-shirt with a right that you think women don't have. Because in her mind, women have all the rights now. It's right. Equal. Everyone has rights. But because men haven't caught up to actually believing that, we don't, actually. Like,
the way that it's educated, even, and I can use the example, you know, when it comes to, like, the black and whiteness of it all, like, people just assume, oh, black people have it so easy because you just get into college because you're black and you get money because you're black. And you're just like, what? There's a disconnect. It's the same thing when it comes to gender roles and dating and marriage. Oh, it's so easy for women now because blah, 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 blah. And you're just like, what?
Yeah, it would be easier if any of you were actually great to date. Like that whole idea that like a woman can walk into a bar and just like have her pick of men. And it's like, what if that woman walks into that bar, sees the spattering of men and immediately goes, ew. Not so easy.
And lest we forget, unless you are a person who is sized like, I don't know, Daisy Edgar Jones, your chances of being able to land a guy are decreased, because men will say things like, there's a video going around on Instagram and TikTok where it's old dating videos from the 80s, and these men who are really have physically no leverage,
yeah,
are saying things like, no fatties, no this, no that, and you're no redheads, no hairy people, and you're just like, who do you think you are that you can say no fatties? Like, sir, this is not, like, you are so, you, like, women are picky? Like, women are, like, you just said. So it makes it even harder when we don't fit the, like, stereotype ideal of, like, what a woman is supposed to physically look like.
Yeah. And then you get an inherent mindset within women that you get what you get and you do not throw a fit.
The amount of times I'm told that I'm being too picky because I would like for them to love me.
Oh, what about like what? You?
Like what? Okay. So what sparks, I think, me give like you and I having this conversation on from my end was the New York Times, Instagram a couple of days before Golden Bachelor release did a post, and the caption read this: the Golden Bachelorette, which premieres next week, is selling a fantasy, but women in their 60s and 70s say the dating scene in the real world isn't quite as rosy. Of course, there's no way to encapsulate the experiences of millions of older women in a single season. Still, there's evidence that the dating scene for straight women in their 60s and beyond may be particularly bleak, and then, you know, swipe all the things. So then I said, is the dating scene rosy at any age? Which is still actively getting likes, by the way. And, like, there are people coming at me who are older women who are like, try dating in menopause. I'm gonna be if I'm still single when I'm going through menopause. Like, I have actively dated since for as long as I could remember. I think my first official boyfriend, I was 15, and I didn't actually even want to date him. It just kind of was one of those things where it's like, we laugh at all his jokes, so obviously you want to date him. No, I can look back now and be like, no, that's not what that was for me, but thanks society for pushing. And then there was a guy who wrote, if you're really attractive, yes. That's what his response to my response was. So then I went down a tangent on close friends on Instagram about how, like, I even pulled pictures from when I was younger. I was like, look at how hot I was even at 32. And I still couldn't pull quality men. So no, it doesn't matter if you're attractive. Like, I would say at 25, I was objectively hot. And I still have what you could say would be a failure in dating track record because I'm not partnered at this point. So it's like we have these delusional concepts that people really believe and will like fight tooth and nail about because of their own lived experience. And you're just like, maybe do some internal work.
Yeah. Well, if you're attractive, yes.
I don't know if you saw my rant because you were on my close friends, but I full on pulled pictures. I gave examples of dating relationships that I've had and how they ended and what men had said to me. Like 10 years ago, I was in a much better place financially and professionally, and I still got dumped.
Well, here's the thing too. Like, if you're attractive enough is a litany of things. It's, are you easy? Were you giving blowjobs? Did you do his laundry? Were you raising his kids? Like, oh, there are ways to make things quote unquote easy for women to get the relationship that they want, but it's always at self-sacrifice to that woman.
Mm-hmm. Just to cap my point is it's hard at every age because men aren't doing the work to be quality partners.
Right. And they don't think that they have to.
Yeah. So it doesn't matter if we're 20 or 30 or 60 or 70, and get to understand that the numbers get smaller once you start entering an age where people are like actively dying because of quote old age. I get that. The point is it really isn't rosy at any age, because the pool of men who you don't feel safe with is larger than the pool of men that you do feel safe with.
Yeah, and the men that you quote unquote feel safe with will still have at the tip of their tongue, why can't you just believe that there are good guys out there? Because I have yet to find one. I have yet to find one that will not turn their back on me as soon as an imaginary man has his feelings hurt.
Or if I'm going through a medical crisis, because the data behind women who are going through and experiencing cancer and cancer treatment who are left.
Ooh. Ooh. And now what I'm seeing is that these women who quote unquote like won the dating game because they got like the white dress and the big wedding and the party, they're now at this impasse where like, you can't prove to me that that's what happiness looks like either, because it looks a lot like, oh, okay, honey, you go to work, I'll stay home and take care of your kid, and you'll resent me every day of my life should I enjoy that kid, because you have to be a miserable fucker who works. Or if you're staying home with that kid and I'm the moneymaker, you're going to resent me for the end of my days because I have a little bit more power than you, and people are going to think that you're a sissy or whatever. So at the end of the day, it's always like, I'm not putting in all of this work to get resented and hated on. And it's detrimental. The amount of times I see women take that on, internalize it, and make it their own anxiety and depression, when I'm like, that's his problem. Mm-hmm. It's his problem that he won't be happy no matter what you do.
Right. And I think there needs to be more bravery to leave. I know it's hard. I've been in a position where partnered people have been like, I don't know how you do it, and blah, blah, blah. And so there's a myriad of reasons why women stay. In what I've observed personally, a lot of them stay because of economic reasons, because it is really hard to like find success independently of a partner. I am proving that every single day. Because there isn't somebody, you know, sharing the financial responsibility. And I'm not saying that's why I want a partner. Like, the other day I realized, like, oh, it sounds like I'm looking for a partner so that way I can have half my bills paid and have an easier time with trying to, you know, get my business off the ground. That's not it. Being in the business world, which is another episode we'll do later, it is really hard to take advice from women about how I should be operating in my business when their finances are taken care of, mm-hmm. because they have a partner who's paying for everything. And whatever resentment comes from that, that's a separate thing for me right now. It's the fact that you want to idolize my life because I'm single and I can do whatever I want, but then also give me advice on how to be successful. But it's like, no, that requires a network and community of people who are willing to like pay for my shit so I can do that. Like, are you going to give me health insurance so that way I can like, and like pay for my bills so that way I can like focus on it? So there's like these little tiny things, because we have this expectation, we created this structure of like, and it's only existed in whiteness because it doesn't exist in, or it hasn't been a thing that's been true for communities of color, because, you know, Black women have always worked in this country regardless of whether it was free labor or, post-slavery labor, you know, other women of color, like, have always worked in some capacity, and it is very much a wealth thing to be able to be a woman who doesn't have to work a job, or a privilege in the sense of, like, I can be a teacher, or I become a doctor, or whatever, right? Like, if you are in a partnership where the husband can pay for everything, and you guys aren't strapped at, you know, living paycheck to paycheck, that's a privilege. And it actually doesn't matter what color you are for that to be a privilege, but it is very predominant in the white narrative because of the way our country was built and structured. and so it's like when it comes to that partnership part, it's like, I'm going to work no matter what. Like, I can't sit around and do nothing. I can for a week. And then I'm fucking bored and I'm wreaking havoc. Like, that's why I can't vacation for long periods of time unless it's intentional. Like, if I'm going to go to Europe, I'm going to do that for a month so I can, like, hit all the shit I want to see. But, like, I can't have free time for long periods of time. So I'm not looking for someone to take care of me. I'm looking for someone to enrich and enhance my life in the way that I feel like I would enrich and enhance their lives.
Well, and you know what's so funny about your rom-com era and the videos that you're making is the very different, it highlights the very different ideologies that men and women have about romance and dating, right? Because like, you're like, it's me. And I'm in my flowy linens and I'm going to the bookstore with my wine and I'm reading a book and I'm waiting for a stranger to ask for a book. Meanwhile, men are still in locker rooms being like, dude, you get laid? Because that's romance to them. The end. And so like, you and I were bred to believe that what leads us to romance and romantic comedy endings and whatever is exactly what you're doing.
Mm-hmm.
But those are all cultural pinpoints and medias that men were shamed for taking in.
Right.
So they have no idea that that's what we're trying to do.
Right. Totally. Like, so originally the idea was going to be like, I'm going to start doing like a bit where I'm doing like dating videos like from the 80s. Where I'm like, I'm Julia. I'm so and so age and I'm looking for blah, 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 blah. And then a friend of mine, married friend, and Natalie, you're going to roll your eyes and cringe at this, but he really does fall under not all men. Like, he is such an ally and such a wonderful.
Him and James McAvoy.
Yeah, like, he's so wonderful. He DM'd me and he was like, I have concerns for your safety if you put that on the internet.
Yeah, because men will lie. Men will lie to you and say that that's what they're into.
And not only that, he's like, what if someone is like a stalker or like all these. So he had very, very reasonable concerns that I listened to. And then I was like, what if I spin it and I do videos that are like, hey, ladies, do you have someone you can vouch for that you might think that I could get along with? Here are some things about me. And then that still felt a little too risky. So then I was like, my friend Libby, giving her a shout out, was like, back in January, she was like, I really feel like you're entering your rom-com era. You're starting a business. You're finally comfortable living alone. Like, I just really feel like you're entering a space now where, like, it's gonna happen. It's gonna happen for you. Like, I feel it. And I was like, I'm stressed out about my job because I'm stressed out about my job and I can't pay attention to this. And then something happened. We were exchanging videos and she was like, Julia, that's a very rom-com thing that happened to you. And then I had a very hard summer, as you know. And so then I was like, oh, I she's fucking right. So then I was like, I'm going to make these videos like I'm the protagonist in the movie. I'm J-Lo. I'm Kate Hudson. I'm Jennifer Gardner. I'm who else? I'm Meg Ryan. Like, and I'm just going to do snapshots of my life and frame it as like a scene you would see from a rom-com movie to sort of highlight those things. Because like that feels safer. Like that feels like I'm still pushing myself to do something that makes me feel out of my comfort zone. Because you know I love to live in my house and never talk to anybody or leave the house ever. But it still allows me the creativity because then too I can like bring in the crowd because I'd be like, what rom-com does this remind you of? What should I be researching for my rom-com era? And it just became and it's you know we're. I think 11 videos in and I have a bunch more content that I'm dragging my feet on editing because I'm currently experiencing extrovert burnout because I did a lot of extroverting recently. And that's working. People are responding to that, which is so nice. So now it's like, all right, if you like it, float it to a friend who's cute. They think that'd be a good fit. Because Natalie, I recently learned about astrography. I don't know if I'm saying it right.
Oh, that is.
So it's basically astrology, but geography in the same thing. And so, like, yes, we have our moons and our stars and the Venus and the Saturn and the Pluto and all the shit. And you have your Gemini moons and Aries rising and Capricornness of it all. But then also, there's like a geographical map about your astrology.
Oh.
So a friend of mine was like, have you ever looked at that? And I was like, I don't know what the fuck you're talking about. So we went to a website, mapped it out, and she's like, wherever your Venus line, you are more likely to find your partner closer to your Venus line. Guess where my Venus line is not?
California.
California.
Oh, you're going to have to travel more.
Uh-huh. So now I'm like, do I start a GoFundMe? Like, do I start a GoFundMe to be like, help me eliminate...
Help me my Venus.
Help me my Venus.
Help me my Venus.
Because I was like, it's near Boston. It's near Halifax. It literally runs straight through Italy and the continent of Africa. I was like, I am no sure. Right? Like, if I choose to fully diehard believe in astrology and like the I don't know how to say it, but I have it in one of my videos. I need to move.
Well, Julia, you've been playing checkers and the stars say you got to play chess.
Do I want to believe it?
Yeah, probably.
Do we want to believe it?
Oh, as you know, as soon as astrology told me that I had a decade of hardship because I'm a Capricorn sun, Libra rising, Cancer moon, and all three of those have been fucked for the past decade, I was like, I am a child of the stars and the stars rule me. And I had always read my charts and my horoscope daily, but I was like, it's all making sense. It's all coming back to me now. I am Selene.
Yes. Yes. Because there are things where I'm just like, okay, no wonder why it feels like I walk into a room like, yeah, these people are attractive, but like nothing's working for me.
Yeah.
Like I'm not actually feeling bonded to anybody.
Mm-hmm.
And it is hard for me to bond with people. Like, that is a true thing. So, like, people I feel bonded to, I'm obsessed with them. Because I'm like, oh, people I actually like. This is so nice. This is fulfilling. This feels fulfilling. I love it.
That's why Julia let me live in her house for a week. For
almost
fun.
Almost two weeks.
Almost 2 weeks.
And, like even though... Like, when I go to L.A., I love my women friends in L.A., but I never really feel like, oh, I'm going to find love here. You know when you, like, go, I don't know if you have this experience, but I've always had the experience of, like, if I go somewhere, I'm like, oh, I feel something good is going to happen.
Oh, I feel that way every time I leave the house because I'm very extroverted. And literally, I had to apologize for Annie last night because two people talked to us at the movie theater. And I was like, I'm so sorry that my energy made two people think that you two would also like two new friends. I'm so sorry that my aura rubbed off on you like glitter. And so these people are like, this girl who literally wants to disappear in her daddy sweatshirt definitely wants to hear my two cents about the movie that she's seen.
I also get misinterpreted as an extrovert because I work really hard to recover from extroverting. So that way when I do leave the house, because I do think it's important. This is a segue. I do think it's important that people feel good. So, like, if you work in, like, we were talking about offline, if you work in customer service and, like, you are not a friendly, kind person, don't work in customer service. Or at least fake it. But I'm not faking it. I have to work. I, like, build up the energy so I can be like, oh my gosh, hi, how are you? I'm so glad you're here. Because I really do believe those things. But in a perfect world, I'd never leave the house, and or if I was forced to leave the house and I wasn't hosting the event, then I'm standing by the snack table.
Well, yeah, and like, here's the thing too, like, a lot of my mental illness presents itself as I'm the main bitch here. Like, I literally asked Annie last night, I was like, what do you...
character energy.
Uh-huh. To like, literally like, TikTok should diagnose me with something, but... I asked Annie last night, I was like, what do you do when you're not the coolest girl in the room? And she was like, it never happens. And I doubt it happens to you. And I was like, no, because like, I don't know if it's the narcissist in me or like, but it haunts me. If someone's just like a little bit more interesting than me, I'm like, how did this happen? I'm the most interesting girl in the room. Like, and I was like, mostly joking. But I was mostly like not joking. I'm like, no, what do we do when there's a bigger star in the room? What do I do if I walk into Starbucks and J-Lo's there. I can't outdo J-Lo.
I mean, it's good practice for you for when you have to go to the Emmys.
Honestly. Oh, my God. Can you imagine? I'm just like at, I'm at the Kids Choice Awards and there's like fucking Sabrina Carpenter being like, me espresso. And I'm like, yeah. I can't compete with Sabrina Carpenter. What can? Am I doing here?
Honestly, who can?
I'm very upset that I'm not seeing Sabrina Carpenter this tour.
Is it terrible that I'm so happy that people on the internet are like, remember when she was the bad guy in The Hate U Give? Lest we forget. Whoever was in charge of her personal branding and marketing and career choices before, whoever's in charge now, did her a disservice.
Honestly, I will always stumble upon a video that's like, the internet is forever, and that's a curse for Sabrina Carpenter.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, though it is gonna help take Diddy down.
Yeah, thank you. I'm like, I want to be at the Sabrina Carpenter show because I too am cool. My sister and her friend yelled at me at Nelly because I was talking to Stephanie. I wasn't even talking to them. I just happened to be near them. But because I was with my very best friend of 20 years, I thought that I could be honest. Yeah. And we're at Nelly and we're waiting for Nelly to start. And I look at Stephanie. I'm just like really upset. I'm just like really upset that I don't get to see Chapel. Because yeah. We didn't get to go when her tickets were like $30. Now her ticket's $400 because she's Chapel fucking Roan. And I go, and I was like there from the beginning. I really just feel like I deserve that. And my sister and her friend were like, oh, you're that lady. You're the I deserve to go see Chapel Roan. Number one, I do. I do. Sorry, I love myself. Sorry, I love myself. That I'm like, I deserve to see Chapel Roan. Chapel Roan wants me to see her. It would be magical. Other people are wasting this opportunity. She's had to scream at her VIP section, you're no fun. I would be fun.
But you bring up a really interesting point to tie it back into dating and dating expectations. There is a very big mentality of, oh, you think you deserve.
Uh-huh.
And that's very American.
It's very American. You think Italians ever worry about whether or not they deserve their gelato? No, they're just getting daily gelato.
Oh my gosh. yes, it's so fun. It's so interesting to learn when other cultures are fat phobic because, like, Italians and Black people are like, you walk through the door and they're like, you're too skinny.
Yeah. Croatians too, at least mine.
You need to eat some food. Who's not feeding you?
Why aren't you eating? God damn it.
And you're like, no, but please don't tell me I'm too skinny because I'm going to go into American society and they're going to be like, why are you the fattest person in the room?
Here's the thing. You know why you can eat gelato every day in Italy? Because it's real food.
And you walk everywhere, probably. I don't know.
Number one, you walk everywhere.
I'm only basing this on things that I've seen that have taken place in Italy. But now we know that my Venus line runs through Italy, so we have to go.
Number two, it's because it's real food. It's not robot food. It's not chemicals that are presenting as food. It's like food from the earth.
Complete side note. The thing that drives me crazy about all this AI stuff and this internet privacy stuff, all these companies are already doing that in Europe.
Listen.
They already have to do it in Europe.
Listen, so like, we have the technology.
For the US and then we'll all be fine. Like, it's so dumb. It's so infuriating how it's like, well, we can't do that here. You're already doing it in Europe.
It's almost like America's a fascist country. You heard it here first. Or from Pearl Mania on TikTok. He screams it a lot. He screams it a lot.
It's just so interesting how capitalism really truly gets in the way of like people finding true love, true happiness, true joy, true authentic relationships that make them feel fulfilled. And that can be platonic or romantic.
Truly, when a lot of couples are fighting with one another and they're like, I don't understand why he doesn't appreciate me. I don't understand why she can't be happy for what she has, this, that, and the other. I don't understand why she's a little bit happier than I am about how her day looks. I'm like, you're not mad at her. You're mad at the American dollar. Like, yeah. You're mad that she technically is bringing no monetary value to your home, so she doesn't get to be happy, even though she's bringing a lot of warmth and love and care into your home. She shouldn't get to be happy about it because she, quote unquote, has no American dollar value.
Yeah. I think, too, the other part of it for me is now that I'm older, like, I don't think I would have been able to walk into a relationship and have the confidence to be like, okay, how are we feeling about our relationship today?
Oh, are you kidding?
Like, and but also I think people my age now would be very uncomfortable. Like, if I was partnered with somebody, it was like, I feel like, and just taking the time to be in relationship with each other, like, I've been saying this for decades, date your friends. Because it makes a big difference. And the same is true for when you have a partnership. Like, you can't just allow life to consume and take away from your ability to be one-on-one with each other. Because then what? You know what I mean? Like, and not everybody has careers that allow them to do pillow talk with their partner. Like, what if I'm, you know, what if I work, like, graveyard shift and my partner works day shift? Like, there's going to be disconnects all the time. It should be normal to have these, like, check-ins with, like, your loved one to be like, how are you feeling about our relationship? Is there something that I'm not supporting you in? Is there something that I am being too, like, what is, you know what I mean? Like, we do that with our friendships. Like, we do, when we are feeling unsupported in friendships, we have no problems calling that person to be like, hey, we're off. I don't like it. I need a break.
Yeah, there are a handful of phone calls that Stephanie has answered the phone being like, I forgot that I had friends. Where have you been?
And I am guilty. Like, I was telling my friend the other day, because I had a huge extrovert weekend. I said, I suffer from forgetting that I have people in my life that want to see me. And I think because I'm so content at home, people don't always think to invite me out either. So it's also kind of, so that makes it my responsibility to be like, remember, I'm here. But like, I think in a romantic relationship, my expectation is, you know, we talk about money and we talk about the status of our relationship. Is that quarterly? I don't know. And I want to fucking date you. Like, if you're my partner, I don't care if we've agreed that this is for life, if we're legally bound together or we just live, I don't give a shit. I want to date you. Like, I want to find things that we enjoy doing together, just the two of us, because that, to me, feels like what's going to keep us strong.
Well, and the thing is, too, is, and I went and saw Speak No Evil twice. So, like, James McAvoy taught me that, like, politeness will be the death of us. Mm-hmm. So it's like, it's impolite to ask your husband, like, hey, do you still like me? And then it's like, what a cringe thing to say. But also, have you ever been like the friend in the friend group who's hungry when no one else is, but you're literally dying? Like, you're dying. Your blood sugar is yo-yoing. You're seeing spots. You can't count. Everyone else is laughing. You don't know what the joke is. You can only think of a hamburger.
Mm-hmm.
But like, how ingrained in it is it for us to not just go, hey, guys, can we like find a snack? Like,
yeah.
Because no one's going to be... No one's going to be mad at you for needing a snack, but like, it's like fighting yourself tooth and nail to be like, hey, I need a drink of water. Hi.
Yeah. And I think too, that it's, you know, a lack of consideration for others as well. Like, if I'm feeling it, maybe someone else is feeling it. Like, when I first had my baby, and it's like, how am I going to know what his needs are? He can't talk. And, you know, my mom was like, well, if you're cold, he's probably cold. And I was
rocket
like,
science.
That makes perfect sense. And so, like, but that concept can translate in so many other aspects of relationships with people. Like, if I need a little snacky, you might need a little snacky. And I do that with my kid. I'm like, you know, hey, I'm going to order lunch. Do you want anything? I know you just woke up. Or like, hey, I'm going to go to the movies. Do you want to come? Like, I try to include the people in my life when I know I'm doing things that other people enjoy doing. I don't, again, I'm not super great at it, but I'm trying to get better. Because, like, it is really lonely. Like, not being partnered is lonely. It's not having the relationships that I can be like, let's go out, let's do, you know what I mean? I mean, I have those relationships. But it's, like, it's so easy to slip into a, I'm not leaving the house, I'm not talking to anybody because I'm perfectly content at home.
We're living the loneliest existence currently. Like, all of the statistics, all of the numbers, all of the data shows that, like, by and large, the reason why depression and anxiety are getting so bad is because we are so lonely.
Yeah.
And I also have found myself taking the pressure off of No too. So like when we went and saw Speak No Evil the second time, by the way, I saw it a second time because I wanted to watch my sister watch the movie. I was like, I want to watch you experience this.
Yes, yes.
Like when I mouth breathed at her during Lisa Frankenstein because I wanted to make sure she knew it was funny. So I was like, that part was funny. And she's like, thank you. I was like, ha 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 ha, funny movie. She's like, okay, thank you. So at one point I did point to her and be like, James McAvoy's in the window. And she did scream. And I was like, that's right. And I didn't want you to miss it. Like, it's very important that you know he's right there.
He's right there.
Do you see him?
I want him to go back to doing rom-coms.
No.
So that's a whole other episode.
You leave my perfect, spooky, buff James alone. You leave him be. You can still laugh at him during Speak No Evil. I did.
You know I'm not going to go see that movie.
You could watch it during the daytime. There's no gore.
I probably still won't, but I appreciate you understanding that I would need to watch it during the day.
It's like one of my new favorite movies. Like, thank you so much, James McAvoy, for all of this joy that you've brought me twice at the movie theater. But and making me feel so seen as a woman who's been told often that I'm impolite because I have needs and a mouth. But I also like to take the pressure off of if your answer is going to be no. Like, I preface this with, I'm going to go see The Substance on Tuesday unless anyone else wants to see it and needs me to wait until they're able to see it. Because mm-hmm. I wanted to see The Substance. I thought it was very important to me as a woman and as a supporter of Demi Moore. And I was like, I'm going to go see The Substance. And it's fine. I have a plan B in my head. I'm mainly in it for popcorn. Like, but I'm going to go. Popcorn and feminism. And like, my sister and her friends had no idea what the movie was about. And then it turns out, like, they're not as into body horror as I am. Isn't that a weird sentence to say? How dare you not be as into body horror as me, a sicko, is? It just makes me laugh. Like, what's wrong with me? Like, body horror? Hilarious.
Only your therapist knows.
And I quit that bitch.
God.
But anyways,
therapy universal.
But like, it turns out it wasn't for them, which is completely fine. I would hate. There is nothing worse to me than going to something with someone who does not want to enjoy this. Like, it makes me insane.
Yeah. In general, like, if you didn't want to come, why did you agree?
Right. Right. I'd rather just go by myself. Now, luckily, Annie was willing to meet me halfway, and then I still managed to make up, mess up geography. And she's like, I know that this spot is physically probably halfway for us. She goes, but traffic-wise and actual highway-wise? And I was like, I don't know how that works. Like, I could barely do this. Like, I don't. So she's going to, I don't know. I'll get better. Yeah. I don't know. I felt real bad. I was like, what do you mean? looked at maps.
But you're also like back somewhere that you haven't been in a long time. You got to get reacquainted.
So whatever. She didn't dump me. Isn't that nice? But like, she was willing to meet me halfway so we could go see the movie and have dinner together. And it's fine. I could have also waited until it streamed. I've also had to do that to my detriment. But it's one of those things where it's like, you don't have to tell me yes because you're afraid that I might die if I don't get to see The Substance.
Right.
I don't want to go to things with you if you are going to make me miserable during them. Remember that couple I was sitting next to during Chelsea Handler who got into a fight during the opener?
Right.
She stormed out and it was very apparent that this was like her thing that she wanted to go, and Bozo was just like mad because this lady was like making fun of men, and he's like, what gives anyone the right to make fun of men? And he just kept whispering shitty things to her until she exploded. Aww. And I was like, why did you come? She could have grabbed her sister, her girl pal. She could have her favorite gay. There are so many people who enjoy Chelsea Handler. Why did you come?
Yeah. Yeah. I think you're just reaffirming for me that, like, for me, the basis of any relationship that I enter into at this point, it's not just building romance, it's building friendship too. Because it's like, I want to not just obligatory love you. I want to like spending time with you.
Well, yeah. And also, and I get it. In the perfect world, you should be able to sit through something that you don't like in honor of your partner or whatever. And every once in a while, that should happen. Mm-hmm. But if you're just going to make me miserable during it, stay home. Just,
and yeah, and that's kind of just how I feel about life in general, which is why I'm like, I'll be single until I die, if that's the case, if I can't find someone who can, like, you know, enhance my life the way I believe I can enhance theirs, because I'd rather not have tension and stress. Like, I like being home. I don't want to live in a situation where I'm like, I don't want to be home. I've actually been in those situations before, and never again. And those weren't even partners. Those were fucking family members. So, like, I can't even imagine in a partnered situation.
And, like, also, I don't even know. And maybe it's because I haven't dated in a while. I don't even know how important it is for me that if I really like to watch Dimension 20, but it literally makes you want to claw your eyes out because you think that Brendan Lee Mulligan's voice is annoying or something. Number one, how are we compatible? Why are you making fun of my... Number one, Lou Wilson, my husband. Why have we turned against Brennan? Yeah. I don't understand. My husband. But like, then don't sit in the room with me. Like, I don't actually want you to have to enjoy the things that I want. I am a full person. Please go sit in the other room. You ever just like show up to something and someone's partner is like dead set on not having a good time. And it's like, sir, this is trivia. Like, not life or death. You could have stayed home.
Yeah, it's designed to be fun. Why aren't you having fun? That's why open concept houses stress me out, because I'm just like, if I want to watch a rom-com and you're not in the mood, you need to have a space to go into then.
No.
Like, whenever I watch HGTV and they've taken down walls and it's one big room and it's the kitchen, living room, dining situation, but everything's like sectioned off with furniture, I'm just like, I'll because if you're watching, again, back to the whole scary movie situation, if you're watching a scary movie and I'm trying to cook lasagna, like, we've got a problem. You need to be able to watch that in a room that I can't see.
Yeah, one time my truth telling tism got the best of me, and a very toxic married couple bought a house, and they had moved from a two-bedroom apartment where one room was their bedroom and one room was the male partner's office and like hobby room. So whenever he was in a tiz, he had somewhere to be that was not a public space. Mm-hmm. But whenever she was in a tiz, all of the places that she could escape to, technically public spaces, right? Mm-hmm. Because like, right. So they moved to a house. It's got three bedrooms now. So they got a bedroom. She uses their guest bedroom as like a little girl sanctuary, and then he has an office. Now, they're a couple that like have no chill, so they very much need to know what you like the best about their new house. So when he asks me this very momentous question that's like going to make or break his life, and my answer is, I like that you both have a space that is clearly your own, because I've been in your house when you guys are fighting and you don't have neutral spaces. And that was like a lot for all of us, which is true, true.
Yeah.
Thank God you fixed that problem. Like, I should have just said the screened in porch. I ruined everyone's evening.
You know what looks great? The screened in porch. Love that for you.
The screened in, these twinkle lights, super cute. But like, literally, they were so emotionally and mentally exhausting that I was like, I like that you both have somewhere to escape to when you're not on your best behavior, and I won't have to watch it anymore.
But that's also kind of a big part of it, because every time I see people who have like an open concept situation and they're mad at their partner, it's always because of something they're doing in that shared space that irritates them. And I'm like,
if you only had somewhere else to be with a wall, and you would never know. You would never know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think, too, again, it goes back to that I didn't explicitly say this, but, you know, there's a lot of growing apart that happens when you are married versus growing together. I think growing together is very intentional. I think growing together is deliberate and takes work. And I think growing apart is very easy and happens a lot because it is very, very easy. Like, well, we're married now, so, like, we've done it. But there's still... Yeah, but there's still, like, milestones that you hit. There's still things that could happen. There's still things that could go wrong. It's like if you never... Here's my analogy. You know, when I grew up in this house, the backyard was gorgeous because people were taking care of it.
No.
We had lush green grass, the greenery, like, the trees were perfect. The fruit trees had the best fruit growing in on them, all the things. I moved back in 14 years later, and I'm just like, oh, this is a shit show. It literally looks like the fucking junkyard in the Sandlot because no one took care of it. They just let it exist. And now I'm doing all this hard work to make it beautiful. And that's what a lot of people I see who are married for 10 plus years are doing. They're either being like, fuck it, I'm done. Or they're being like, okay, we got to clean out. We got to clean the shit out and make it pretty again.
Yeah.
And I'm not saying that I want to avoid any hard times. That's not what I'm saying. I'm just saying in my observation, in the few relationships that I've had, being a single for as long as I have been and being able to get to know myself as well as I've been able to get to know myself, I know that I need regular maintenance in my relationships in order for them to be successful.
Yeah.
Because I've also observed in my friendships, when there isn't regular maintenance, shit gets weird, awkward, uncomfortable. It happens. Like, why should I assume that my romantic relationship is any different than a platonic one when it comes to maintenance?
Yeah. Well, Julia, we should probably move into the closing out part. What would you like to tell us is your biggest lesson from your rom-com era?
I think the biggest, like, duh moment, like, I think I subconsciously knew this, but I didn't say it out loud, was men and women walking into dating with very different expectations. Like, we know this intrinsically, but to actually actively see it in front of my face because now I'm doing the work is a completely different experience.
Have you seen the Giggly Squad video about this? Hannah Berner read an article, I don't remember which one, but she said that it, like, changed her entire life. Hannah Berner was like, do you realize that when men walk into a dating situation for the first time, they're starting at zero and mm-hmm. everything is either a tick up or a tick down.
Right.
Women start at 100, giving you the complete benefit of the doubt, and then, like, men chip away. But if you're starting at 100 and it's like, oh, his breath stinks, all right, that's probably like a 98. It's still a really long time before you're gonna, like, eject yourself out of it. But if mm-hmm. you're a man and I've only made, like, 7 good points and then it's like, she's not available on Thursdays and that ticks me down, that's way closer to zero.
Yeah. Yeah. Gosh, that's wild. I guess I don't go into anything with expectations anymore.
Oh, but so here's the thing, too. I don't even think the 100 is, like, an expectation that you're going to treat me right. I think the 100 is, like, the expectation of, this is just going to work out because, like, we both got out of our house or whatever. Like, I very much get into that mindset where it's like, why would you want my company if you're a racist? I don't understand.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I know why, because fetishes. I mean, for me on my end,
why?
Because I, you know, was fetishized for when I was hot, I was very fetish. When I had a fit body and my thighs looked good uncovered, I was fetishized all the time.
Yeah, but I'm always like, you agreed to be here too. You were also into this going well. But, like, no, they're, like, literally, like, waiting for you to prove that this was worth their time. And you've already decided that it's worth your time.
Oh, that's so funny. I'm going to have to think about how I approach those things because I do. I leave the house with the, just throw spaghetti at the wall and see what happens now. Like, I feel like that's kind of also my video is too, where it's like, let's see what happens. Like,
so, yeah, I'll find that Giggly Squad video. Hannah and Paige, if you ever want to be friends, I'm going to just clip this and send this to you just because. Like,
Do it. Because it is really, I mean, just the whole dating's just so interesting. And then I went through, like, a couple of days, and that's probably why I'm dragging my feet and editing the newest content because I have like two or three videos that I need to cut together, where it's just like, oh, everyone on TikTok and Reels is fucking hot. Like, these women and men are insanely attractive. The way, like, are you in the gym 2 hours a day? Do you have a person making healthy food for you? I'm lucky if I put on clean clothes some days, okay? And so, there are moments when I'm like, what am I doing? Like, I'm working on the whole, like, you can't be lovable if you're not, like, Nicole Kidman skinny. Like, working on that because, like, I feel very confident when I do things and then I put it on the internet and then the internet is like, oh, you like dating stuff? Here's a bunch of videos about dating and everyone looks like Hollywood hot. And then I'm just like, well, thanks for that. My ego's been crushed a little bit and I'm going to have to go hide in a corner now.
What's your manifestation?
I mean, loving and selfless partner.
Yeah, I figured that's what it would be.
Should it be anything else in this topic?
No. My manifestation, so Annie and I planned out a TikTok that I could do where it's like me moving back to Northwest Indiana and trying to find the girls, gays, and theys, and I'm just walking around going, pink pony, yeah. And then waiting. H-O-T-T-O-G-O.
Haven't you seen that video where the gal's walking around, she's like, I'm in a bodega, I think there's gays here, and then she starts singing a Cher song, and then, like, sings the one opening thing, and then everyone, and, like, she's like, I found them.
Yeah, I'm sure that does happen in bodegas, wherever she's at. I'm in the Midwest. I need to put forth...
I feel like Cher would also work in this scenario. Because if you can find a Cher-loving gay in New York, you can find a Cher-loving gay in the Midwest.
You know what I'm manifesting for myself? More girls, gays, and theys who want to roll dice with me and play D&D and D&D adjacent games.
I love that. I think that's great.
I might also make a video where it's like me trying to find the girls, gays, and theys who get it and like yell things like, roll initiative!
Geotag that shit.
Right. I cast silvery barbs.
I don't know what any of that means.
And because you're not a girl, gay, or they who gets it, but the ones who get it will get it.
That's true. I think the other part of my manifestation is to, because I'm planning a trip to Canada to visit a certain friend in 2026, is the other part of that manifestation is that actually happening. I'm saving money. Yeah. But as we've learned over the summer, shit happens and life gets derailed. And so the other part of my manifestation is to make it to Canada because where we're going is near Halifax, which is where my Venus line runs through.
One of my manifestations is a certain friend of the podcast and ours. And I found out through the magic of Emily in Paris that in Chicago, there's an hour on the hour. Every hour, there's a plane that'll take you to New York and then a plane that'll take you home from New York. And we were like, why didn't we know that? Yeah. And now, like, literally now it's as easy as, like, a 2-hour plane ride any day we could want to do it. And, like, hopefully Lily Collins wasn't lying.
No, because it's in Hello Beautiful, the book. It comes up in Hello Beautiful. It's a thing that one of the characters does. She does an hour flight from New York to Chicago.
I mean, I feel like, come on. I could be...
And, like, wouldn't it be amazing? Sorry, 1, 2, 3, back to me. Wouldn't it be amazing if I was on Prince Edward Island and met a professional oyster shucker who had Gilbert Blythe vibes and was like, sure, I'll move to America with you, even though Canada's probably better for our health. Unless we can convince my kid to also move to Canada, because we both know I can't live far away from him.
Annie and I were watching Ultimate Girls Trip, Real Housewives, where they were at Dorinda's Bluestone Manor, and she threw for them a seafood broil, whatever you call it, a shellfish broil. And I told Annie, I was like, I know, because like now they're tearing apart shellfish on camera, and it's very visceral. And I told Annie, and I was like, listen, I know that I would never be able to do this on camera, brave. Or in public, but damn, like there is something about just like cracking crab legs and then being like, I eat this now. That's like, very horror coded that makes my sicko brain be like, yeah. And Annie also said, she goes, oh, I get to beat up my food before I eat it. Yes. Like,
gosh, that's so funny.
Yeah, because we're sick. It's fine. It's fine. So yeah, my manifestation is to find the girls' gays and theys, because I only want to play D&D and D&D adjacent activities with the girls' gays and theys who get it. and you know what? Girls is sometimes a very broad term, because like that also includes Dave Bautista and Papa Pascal for some reason. Like, I don't make the rules.
Yeah, like if Dave Bautista wanted to be the leading man in my rom-com, I would not be mad.
Dave Bautista, I hope you know how loved you are on Team Tolerator, okay? I go to bat every day for Dave Bautista. Every day I'm like, you know who's the greatest person on earth? Dave Bautista. You see him play with those puppies?
Like, why did it take so long to give us the puppy Dave pop tent?
I am literally clipping this. Like, Dave, every time someone has a rom-com, like, because I know writers, okay, Dave? I know writers. I am also a writer.
I mean, like, in my real life. Like, sure. If I'm sitting at one of my current favorite spots to read in public in Modesto, and I'm sitting there with my book and my Cosmopolitan 1934 and my girl dinner, and he walked in and sat down next to me and also opened a book, and then at the end of the night was like, hey, can I get your number? I would say yes.
All day, every day. But Dave, I'm talking to you directly. I'm a writer. I know writers. I know writers who know prolific people, like real high. Like, you think of someone in your head and we'll figure out if I know someone who knows them. Every time they bring up a romantic comedy adjacent script, like something that I think I could turn into a romantic comedy, I'm like, we have to cast Dave Bautista.
Yes, yeah.
Because I read one time that Dave Bautista has gone out for rom-coms and hasn't gotten callbacks, and now he's insecure that he's not pretty enough for rom-coms. And Dave Bautista, I need you to know, with my whole chest, with my whole chest, on a podcast where I'm not supposed to be sticking up for men, you are beautiful. You're the only person I want to see in rom-coms, it turns out. You've never done anything wrong in your entire life. And I would love to write that rom-com with you. You call me. You call me. Okay? I got people on lockdown. Okay? We can do this. We can do this together, Dave. You, me, Lenny Kravitz, Papa Pascal, we can make this happen. We can make this happen. Okay, Dave, I'm gonna cut this and put it on TikTok, because that's how I got to be friends with Rosie O'Donnell. And that's how I got Katie Maloney to give me attention. So cutting it, I'm putting it on TikTok. I'm gonna be like, Dave, it's me and you. It's me and you, Dave Bautista. Me, you, we can have the whole world. I promise. I promise. I will make that happen for you, Dave.
Not only would I pay money to see him in a rom-com several times, like I said before, if he were to show up at a certain bar that is featured several times in my rom-com series and sit next to me reading a book and then ask for my number at the end of the night, I would say yes.
Dave Bautista, I love you, okay? I need you to know that you're my only hope, okay? You're my Obi-Wan Kenobi. You're my only hope in me ever enjoying a rom-com. We love Dave Bautista on Team Tolerator. Yes. We talk about him all the time. There are other men who have come to the top of that, like James McAvoy and Dan Stevens. Hello, allies.
Oh, I love Dan Stevens. Matthew Crawley.
Okay, but do you know why I love Dan Stevens?
He's in movies I will never see.
Yeah, because now he's a weirdo. Now he's a cold cop weirdo. Hey, Dan. Can't wait for us to be friends because we're weird. Hey, Dan. I love weird Dan Stevens. It's my favorite. If only I were still straight now that Dave Bautista and Dan Stevens are weirdos.
I can't wait for Downton rewatching season to come. Sorry, yeah, Natalie. Sure.
And I'll just be watching Cuckoo. I'll be watching the Godzilla Kong movie where they fight, but it's all about found family. Be watching Dave Bautista with those puppies while him and I get on a Zoom call about our rom-com. Dave Bautista, yeah. It's me and you, and we can make the whole world happen, baby. I know it. I know it. That amount of charm in one room, my charm, Dave Bautista's charm, forget it. We're president. We're the ultimate ruler. We've taken over the moon. We've done it.
Yeah.
So anyways, Julia, congrats on your rom-com era. I'm sorry that took a weird turn where I'm like, I'm going to make this my love letter to Dave Bautista real quick. Excuse me, Julia, go away. I need to talk to Dave. I need to talk to Dave Bautista. I haven't talked to him in a while. Just love him. I just love him.
honestly, he's hard not to love.
You know how I think like a hug from Eugene Levy would cure me? You know, like heal all of the generational trauma just like simmering in my body.
The childhood wounds.
Just the wounds, the gaping wounds in my soul. Same with Dave Bautista. I'm leaving all of this in. I'm only going to cut part of it for TikTok, the cool part.
Yeah, but I'm here for it. I support that.
Yeah, so anyways, Julia, tell everyone where they can find you, and then I'll plug Dave Bautista stuff.
To quote my friend, there's no shortage of me on the internet. You can, if you want to follow along my rom-com journey, it is on TikTok and on Instagram, The Julia Washington, THE Julia Washington. If you want to shop my shop, Pose and Glow, it is juliawashingtonproductions.com, even though I own poseandglow.com. Cannot figure out how to switch them. So that way you can shop proseandglow.com. No, you have to go to juliawashingtonproductions.com to shop Pros and Glow, because I'm great at business. And there you can find literary-inspired candles. Do I need to make... Well, he's a movie boy. Here's what we need. We need Dave Bautista to play the leading man in a movie that's been adapted from a book, so I can make a character candle, because I make... I have a boyfriend candle series.
Yeah.
So then that way we can make him a candle.
For Dave? Yeah.
Yes. Because they always describe what boyfriends smell like in romantic comedy books. Yeah.
So basically.
Which is the inspiration behind the candle line.
Dave, write in what you smell like. I know you know. I know you've been told. You write it. Someone write in to me what Dave Bautista smells like.
Okay, but I feel like it's less creepy if he plays a character in a movie that's based on a character in a book and I do it from there. Like, that feels less, like, inappropriate. That feels more on brand.
For him to just like, tell me what his brand of cologne is? I don't think so. If he DMs me and he's like, it's Elm and Sage, that's not creepy. He's just answering a question.
So then you can shop juliawashingtonproductions.com.
I smell like coconut milk right now, if anyone was wondering.
And you can buy the boyfriend series candle, literary inspired candles, also hand painted greeting cards. And also if you're in California, I host book parties and I would love to see you there.
And we're at Men I've Tolerated Pod on Instagram, To All the Men I've Tolerated Before on Patreon, NatalieK124 on TikTok, where you'll see me and Dave make a beautiful friendship. So
can't wait.
And you can check out when Rosie O'Donnell comments on my stuff. So she did that. Yesterday.
Yes. When I opened up TikTok, it was like, Rosie O'Donnell commented on a TikTok you're tagged in. I was like, what?
Because we're friends.
Me Rosie O'Donnell.
Icon. Pushball icon Rosie O'Donnell. Mm-hmm. So go follow us on all of those things. And remember, tolerators, you don't have to smile through anything you're tolerating, including ridiculous beauty standards that make people feel bad about themselves. So they've never made Dave Bautista a leading star in a rom-com until I do it, coming 2032. My rom-com with Dave Bautista. Just called Natalie Did This. Smiles are for joy.